East Germany in the 1980s. Cold War relations are at a new low. It's a dangerous place to operate for the foreign missions. In 1984, French soldier Philippe Mariotti is killed when his vehicle is driven off the road by the Stasi. In 1985, American Major Nick Nicholson is shot dead by a Soviet sentry. But despite the dangers, none of the mission members were armed. No BRIXMIS operatives carried weapons when they went out on tour.
A couple of absolute no-nos were, we never took out anything written down about the targets that we had to get, because we're always very conscious that any moment the vehicle might be rammed, we might be broken into, and so everything in the vehicle would be turned out by the Soviets, and every bit of evidence that they could find to incriminate us, you know, would be useful. So we never took anything out about the targets. The only things we marked on our maps, our mappings, was a little Z, which was a Z-Platz, where we used to sleep at night. And the other one was a little ice cream cone that we put over the map, which was where the ice cream parlours were. Because again, you know, it's hot out on tour, and we often used to like to stop for an ice cream. We only found out when a vehicle got turned over and the Soviets took the maps out, and they accused us of either plotting nuclear detonations of ours on them, or where we thought their nuclear storage sites were. Because of the little conical shape of a cone and a little fluffy bit over the top, they thought these were little mini nuclear explosions, which I have to say, Chief of Mission found extremely amusing, and so did we. I think it only encouraged us to increase the amount of ice cream stops we put on our maps.
BRIXMIS tours were on the road for days at a time. They say they spent more time under canvas than any other unit in the British Army.
We do anti-surveillance, or denarking as we used to call it, beforehand, because we wanted to make sure that we weren't disturbed at night when we were sleeping. You'd be doing at least 18-hour days, you know, watching railway lines and things. And actually, for most of us, this was the boring bit. We went to bed thinking what we'd be missing, what we're missing while we were asleep. Go to great lengths to make sure that we weren't followed. You know, we'd go hundreds of kilometres if necessary. We'd always sleep fully clothed, take our boots off, and in the winter, we had these hot bags that you break open and then have some on your hands and some on your feet, get into your kennel tent, and that was it for the night. You'd be, you know, snug as a bug in a rug. In we go. Boom, boom.
Passage of foreign military liaison missions prohibited. Written in English, French, Russian and German. These signs had a very clear message.
This sign normally lives in my shed at home on the back of the door. The Soviets put these signs around all of their training areas and installations. And of course it was a double-edged weapon. The Soviets thought these signs were there to keep us out, but for us, it just told us there was something worth looking at behind them.
Despite this gung-ho attitude to security, breaking into Red Army headquarters would have been out of the question even for BRIXMIS. But today, Dave's joining a coachload of veteran spies on a visit to the Russians' former HQ in Sachsen-Wunsdorf. This is the so-called secret village, once home to as many as 75,000 Soviet soldiers and their families.
I'm glad they didn't pull all these down, you know, and destroy them like they normally would have done.
A giant statue of Lenin still stands outside what was once the Russian Cultural Centre. Today, the houses are out of bounds to the public, run down and semi-derelict. Despite the decay, there are still signs of the former HQ. Grand staircases, long corridors, high ceilings and high security.
Clearly not allowed in this bit. Yeah.
Soundproof.
Soundproof, yeah.
for confidential discussions and not interrogation
cells. We didn't have the ISO container like we had. Oh, here we go, Rod. Bit of a stage.
Beyond the village, a hidden complex of bunkers. The underground Soviet operations centre was hidden beneath these buildings which stood on the surface, made to look like typical German houses to disguise their real purpose.
What interesting for us was the guys who'd been in these bunkers before is the smell. That smell was very familiar to us as we walked in, you know, that sort of damp, dank smell, which even was the case when they were occupied, and the bunkers we went into during my time in the mission still suffered from damp and stuff like that. So it was very interesting, very nostalgic to go back in.
For other members of the tour party, there's another source of excitement. In the communications bunker, an original Soviet telegram log, once top secret, is now on open display.
I kind of get jittery because that's the kind of stuff that we really wanted to find. Yeah.
And for you, you'd be searching through the dumps, through all kinds of stuff to find this sort of thing.
This would be the golden nugget. That's right. Or if we went into a training area where they had been with a signals unit and we found this. Interestingly enough, the Soviet army did not issue toilet paper to their soldiers. And so frequently what would happen is that the soldiers would rip out pages of a log and use it to wipe their butts. So we found out where they pooped in the woods, and we would actually go through that with a stick and gloves, trying to pick up the pieces, and we took them back with us in plastic bags.
And that was worth your while?
Yes. Yes, it was.
Did you find good stuff doing that? Because it's a hell of a job.
We found good stuff doing it. Yes, we did. It was just part of the job, and we enjoyed it.
30 years ago, if we'd have been caught here, we'd have been shot. You know, no doubt about it. And now just shows you, so what we risked our lives and limbs for to get intelligence information all those years ago, now, of course, is all freely available. You know, we were spying, and they knew it, and we knew they knew it. And that was part of the game back then. We feel very lucky to have been part of that intelligence gathering machine, you know.
The American sister mission, the USMLM, had just 14 members compared to the 31 in BRIXMIS, but they operated in a similar clandestine way. Former Major General Mike Ennis spent 3 years on tour with the USMLM.
If there was ever going to be a conventional attack, it was going to start in East Germany.
Yeah.
And as a result, a lot of their best equipment and their newest equipment came in. So we were out there trying to find out. We monitored rail lines.
Yeah.
We were on the roads. We looked around installations to find out what they had. The T-80 tank, for example. ZSU or the 2S6, things like that. Yeah. The SA-11, the book system.
Yeah. You know, I was there from 86 to 89. Mm-hmm. And
as was I, yeah.
People regard that as like the heyday, because that was when we saw the greatest amount of newest Soviet equipment being introduced into GSFG. And for us, of course, that gave us a tremendous ability and capability to capture it either on film or on video or some of the other means we had.
And then there were the serendipitous things, like when the MiG-29 crashed, and we watched the Soviets come out and haul away all of the pieces, and after about 2 or 3 days, they came with a bulldozer and grated over the site.
Yeah.
Well, for the next 2 weeks, we went in at night on our hands and knees and dug down, and we were able to get about 350, 400 pounds of electronics, of metal, and we found out from that the Soviets were actually further ahead in their metallurgy than we had actually realized.
2562P, small r, Scud B, no markings.
A lot of, you know, what we did and how we did it and the success we had was in part due to the enthusiasm of the guys on the ground, like me and you,
right.
You know, who went to extraordinary lengths, like you just said, crawling about in the dark at all hours
in
of the day
mud.
And night,
yep.
In the mud, you know, to find a mere scrap of something,
that's
which
right.
We took back. You know, I remember a friend of mine, a signals unit, left a deployment area and they burned all their crypto stuff and it was still on fire. And I always got this vision of my friend running into the site and diving into the fire, into the flames, to save some of the bits that hadn't been burnt. You know, and then we subsequently found out, you know, from the intelligence agencies that this was absolutely vital, you know, from that little scrap of digital stuff that, or whatever, right. Crypto stuff.
Partially burned.
Yeah, so all that rolling about in the fire, you know, definitely paid dividends.
And another thing that would demonstrate some of the aggressiveness is that I had watched an airfield being built up in the north. And I wasn't sure whether it was East German or Soviet. As it turned out, it was Soviet. And I mentioned this to one of the guys on the air team. And he said, is it being built? And I said, yes. It's under construction? I said, yes. He said, has the runway been laid? And I said, yeah. He said, is it guarded? And I said, no. So on his next tour, he took a sledgehammer with him and went up and actually broke off a piece of the runway. And after the analysis was done of the concrete, we came to learn that it was actually of such a composition that could have defeated some of our more active bombs, if
yeah.
you will.
You know, that sort of thing wasn't taught to us. You know, right. That was like just playing on our strengths as ordinary
what we
soldiers and Marines. And
this was a unique time in history. The 1947, yeah. with all the agreements between the four powers and the aftermath of World War II, and it turned into a reconnaissance, a clandestine reconnaissance outfit, and that's exactly what we did.
Yeah, exactly.
It was this mixture of daring and ingenuity that made the BRIXMIS teams so successful.
Okay, start moving forward.
But how did they cope when their luck ran out?
It had seen our tour vehicle in the woods, and then fundamentally, as it went up behind us, we were then cut off.
Don't forget to like and subscribe if you enjoyed this video, or why not check out the rest of the BRIXMIS series.